good evening, guys. I hope you're all doing really, really well. My name is ALYSSA Maurer. I'm going to be giving an artist presentation about my work. So let's get started. I think it's important to know my background before getting to know my work because my background has played a pivotal influence in the things that I explore. I find myself questioning aspects of innocence, miscommunication between rural and urban demographics, and how my childhood landscape impacted my creativity, so where I got started. To sum it up, the place I grew up was a place of communal teaching. The village very much so raised the child, and everyone knew or gossiped about everyone else. I've always blamed boredom on this. There aren't many businesses or outlets for social gatherings or events within these communities, except for Sundays when there's church and the dirt mall is open, or the flea market. Boredom was or is also the result of creativity in these regions. You have to be creative in order to surpass boredom in these areas, and I took this exercise and grew on it exponentially. So I grew up in Duncansville, Pennsylvania. No relation to Dunkin' Donuts, by the way. I was close to Altoona, however, and that's where the Boyer's Candy production company started, and also the Sheets family started their gas station takeover. My school, as seen from this satellite view, thank you Google Maps, was smack dab in the middle of cornfields. The closest business was the Ritchie's Dairy Farm, and then the rest was Amish country. My school bus in particular took about 45 minutes to an hour to get to school, depending on whether or not we got stuck behind a horse and buggy on our way. Alright, so what did I gain from high school or homeland experiences, and why is this important? I learned how to laugh at myself when I failed, or even just in general, failure isn't a bad thing. It's only bad when you don't learn anything from it. And here I have a quote from Frank Herbert, who is author of the Dune series. He says, "I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer. Fear is the little death that brings total obliteration. I will face my fear. I will permit it to pass over and through me. And when it has gone past, I will turn the inner eye to see its path. Where the fear has gone, there will be nothing. Only I will remain." Oh yeah. Out of boredom and trying to escape my hometown, I went to São Paulo, Brazil. I did a foreign exchange whenever I was 15. My bachelor's art degree is in photography from Poe Park University, where I steadily transitioned, essentially moving from a self-proclaimed photographer or Tumblr idiot, as I would like to say, into something of a decent practitioner. My first show here was called Trash Monsters, which took place my sophomore year, where I had made costumes out of discarded materials, assigned them identities based on those materials, and had participants model in the costumes. I was fascinated by inorganic material and how it would look when it became sentient. Kind of like if Andy from Toy Story came into his bedroom and his toys were still moving and playing. Because I was still fairly new to my university though, no one attended the show. But the best thing that I can tell you guys is don't let attendance though stop you from having a good time. Stop me, 'cause I'm having a good time, having a good time. I'm a shooting star leaping through the sky like a tiger, defying the laws of gravity. Thesis work. So my thesis analyzed chronic narcissism. That work started out after I was excruciatingly concerned with social media as a pedestal for proliferating narcissistic personality traits. So I went to a psychoanalyst and I got analyzed for that disorder exclusively. I found out that I was exhibiting, that I was like one trait away from being considered a diagnosable narcissist. So this led me to do research and self-development. During this time, I would count how many times I said I in a sentence. Through the development of the work, though, I was able to come to terms with this disorder by shrouding myself in the advertisements and media that targeted consumer identities for their own benefit. So phrases like that, which are often used in advert strategies. So by bringing this to the forefront and showing how it embellishes or generates a false sense of self. So I began by making masks out of those advertisements, which I call the propaganda portion of the project. Moving forward, used that material as masks that I put on myself. Technically, these are self-portraits. This is a self-portrait series, but I really don't associate any of these portraits with myself anymore. These are kind of like the false sense of self. And if I go back to the quote, which says the false self replaces the narcissist's true self and is intended to shield him from hurt and narcissistic injury by self-inputting omnipotence, the narcissist pretends that his false self is real and demands what other affirms this confabulation to be. And that is from a actual diagnosed narcissist. And was part of my research. I bring up Pablo Helguera's Education for Socially Engaged Art. My work in grad school really began when I started to engage with people, working as a bartender on the weekends and through online discourse via video chat rooms. These people either excited me and warranted some kind of project, or there were questions about their character or actions that provoked personal inquiry. He says this on page 4. For those whose goal is to work with others, generally in collaborative projects with democratic ideals. Many artists look for ways to renounce not only object making, but authorship altogether. Definitely something that I was looking in. And in the kind of stealth art practice that philosopher Stephen Wright argues for, in which the artist is a secret agent in the real world with an artistic agenda. And in this first performance piece, I was coming up with random numbers in the 513 area code region and then calling them and asking them if they would tell me a story or if they could tell me to do something. And as you can see from the picture, a lot of people said no or didn't answer. I started immediately after that project failed. I went on to make these things that I call 412s. And essentially, it's an artist reference binder. So I print these out and you make them in Photoshop. And then you have a physical copy of like every artist that you want to reference back to, and you don't have to rely on the internet to do them. And then this is something that I've gone to incorporate in not only my practice, but also in my teaching. These were the themes that I was exploring. And what I decided was that I was going to start by investigating my own definitions of innocence, whether that was innocence that we see in judiciary courts or the innocence that is established by conventions in religion. This was some of the work that happened out of that. I was doing a lot of collage imagery. Straight from my undergrad, I really identified as a collage artist, and I really enjoy the medium because I think that for interdisciplinary artists, it works as a great way of collecting your thoughts onto one sheet of paper from multiple things. So I started completing these diagrams, and then the project that resulted out of that was called Letters from Outside the Bowl. This series of letters go in tangent with aspects of innocence, where a fictional character is developed in order to cope with trauma, displacement, and conflict. We see these types of characters or imaginary friends found not only in children, but in adults with mental disabilities and supernatural encounters. Schizophrenia, dissociative identity disorder, apparitions, etc. They reveal, according to several theories of psychology, a child's anxieties, fears, goals, and perceptions of the world through the child's conversations. This is just one example of the letters. I'm not going to read it for you, but essentially it's me blaming Cleo, which is in turn blaming myself for watching pimple popping videos on YouTube. And I had a presentation that day, and it came up in my search results history whenever I logged into Google right before I was giving the presentation. So I had like a really weird look from the audience that I was giving this presentation to. And so I kind of went home and wrote this letter blaming Cleo for it and saying like, why would you do that? I inherited my grandmother's photographs, and I was exploring like the burden of that inheritance. So I went through and I scanned each one individually, and then I started to throw them up on walls, enlarge them, cut out certain bits, and then install them. And then this was the installation from that project that kind of encapsulated everything. Finally, this is Ragtime. This is called, I just prefaced this with conversations with men while they masturbated. Subsequent to that, this is a warning. There are dicks in this work. So if you're uncomfortable with that, you might want to look away. And here's the video. so reasons why, I'll let you read over those, but I wanted to have conversations with people from the comfort of my bedroom. Digital technology has afforded this comfort, and its users are very much so uninhibited. So during my conversations with people online, I would come across a population of men openly masturbating. Instead of skipping over them, I decided to document, ask questions, and grasp a general consensus of understanding from a female perspective. The work incorporates photography and sculpture to better explore the three pivotal exchanges that happen during each encounter, conversation, climax, and aftermath as a landscape. It was a provisional sculpture, actually. Conversations with the men were documented while on the verge of climax. Articles of donated clothing were scanned and exhibited to address the variety of items used during orgasm. So this is, I was playing around with grids and how I wanted to, finally exhibit the work. So I just collected all of the screenshots from those conversations, and keep in mind, I, made it a point to, tell these men that I was recording them. So they know, and I have all of their names written down. I set up a PO box to and encourage these guys to send me their used cum rags, which they did. But don't worry, though. Yeah, I took safety precautions pretty seriously. So from the materials that I received, I scanned them, and I got a lot of really weird stuff, I'm not gonna lie. And like I said, I scanned them, and then I, turned them into imagery, and then some of them, I wanted to create a piece about the collection that I was receiving, and, like, the sheer amount of, like, one thing that I got. One of the things that I got the most of was used tissues, and so I put them into a container, and I turned them into sculpture pieces by pouring epoxy resin over top of them. So, after rag time, I really needed some downtime, and so that video is from work that I was developing, which was about the infinite temporal, or the idea that some moments last for what is perceived as an infinite period of time. And for the longest time, I didn't feel like I was ever present, and I kept trying to act out in order to feel present. Like, I went skydiving. I don't recommend this, and I don't condone this, but I took acid and went into a isolation chamber. But exploring communication and socialization as an avenue for achieving presence. And so this is the photograph that I took from that moment. And then in order to kind of like romanticize about how pleasing and perfect that moment was and how it'll never be experienced again, I kind of wanted to solidify it in time. So I painted over it with acrylics and inks in order to accentuate the features of it. This happened. This is Lydia. I guess we'll just play this one. Everybody was kung fu fighting. Those kids were fast as light. Essentially, she got decommissioned, so I had to get a new one, and she wasn't happy about it. And then there was this. So I was trying to fly the sex doll in front of churches. That really didn't work out very well. And also, this accompanying work that sort of, these collages that went with it, I think, me and my mentors all agreed that this was like a little bit too far. The current work, my thesis work, I'm calling it the digital Barmecide, just to tell you guys what the Barmecide technically is. So it's an adjective, and it's the illusory or imaginary and therefore disappointing. Or as a noun, a person who offers benefits that are illusory or disappointing. If anyone is familiar with Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. Towards the end, there's the scene where the main protagonist walks into this room that the aliens have, like, manifested for him. That's actually an installation piece, and it's called Feast of the Barmecide.
Okay, so the research behind this project, now that I got the title out of the way, so the title Barmecide and the way that it relates with the project is that whenever I moved away from my partner to pursue my graduate degree here in Cincinnati, I realized that, what social media was doing and the way that we were operating this relationship was very much so about that illusory state. It was there, but the physical connection could never happen. And so I went into research. I did interviews about long-distance or non-proximal relationships, and I found some really interesting results. What I did was I conducted research by finding people who were also experiencing what I was experiencing, which is long-distance relationships, and how do these people sort of navigate that landscape of maintaining a relationship while abroad. And in doing some of my research, I came across this amazing book called Commuter Spouses, Relationships in the New World. And the book has some interesting information on the rise of these relationships and this particular demographic. What it predicts is that as soon as the job market became more competitive and simultaneously people in relationships were realizing that they no longer needed to rely on one singular breadwinner in order for their family to function. Gender stratification being out of the picture, and with individualism now sort of reigning in these relationships, coinciding with the competitive job market, it freed up the availability for these people then to travel for their work for extended periods of time, which is then how we get to this current situation, especially the one that I was dealing with at the time. In my particular case, I moved away to pursue a upper academic degree, a master's degree. Coincidentally, these types of degrees are any sort of thing past a bachelor's. It's very uncommon for your alma mater, the people who give you your bachelor's degree at the university, whomever, you generally do not accept applications from their already graduated students. This is normally done so that way they can siphon in new students and make other ones go away. And so one of the first ways that this project manifested into a visual plane was after I had discussed my desire to live inside my partner's chest cavity, which I will say this is bizarre, but not until you start to understand this idea of safety, and I don't want to talk about Freud, but the idea of sort of living inside somebody's cavity or taking on somebody's struggles, putting them inside your body so that way nothing bad can happen to them. That type of sincerity and fascination with the person was what I was starting to explore with my work. My first way of doing this was in, you know, I asked myself, okay, if I was going to take something from somebody or if I was going to emblemize that situation, how would I do it? And so I started to make these bags, and the way that they work is that I would collect items from other people, and as this sort of new way of forming artifacts for memory and for remembrance. And these then, I kind of see them as body bags in the sense that they're made up of not just a visual aspect of somebody's life, which is where photography sort of normally lays at. These are then filled with honey, so there's a sweetness aspect to them. And then there's bitterness too. These bags have cigarettes, they have bottle caps, and I wasn't taking any items in particular, just items from the time that I would spend with these people and the things that they left behind. I also always asked them if I could take these items, but this began to talk about the landscape that people in long-distance relationships sort of explore as they're away from their partner. I collected trace elements of people's existence around me in order to make up for the fact that it wasn't there to help me out in the same way as what he would normally do. Instance where this project started to manifest was whenever I was tying these 5 centimeter strings, which are 5 centimeters is actually like the average length of the human heart, and I kept tying them together until they became this very root-looking thing. I started tying these knots out of, I don't want to say resentment, but after reading about this Chinese proverb that says that talks about the string of fate, which is this idea that this red string connects two people together who are meant to be together, and the string can never be broken. And I kind of thought that was bullshit. I think that there are people in our lives that we connect with, and sometimes we separate. That doesn't necessarily mean that the string can't still be tied back together. And so I wanted this long string to sort of represent all those relationships that we break away from and then tie back together into this very elongated thing. And the beauty in that, I think, was very inherent. First draft, so this was kind of like me putting together all of these themes into different visual planes, and so I wanted to combine the idea of me ripping apart my partner's chest cavity. Like, how would that look like if I actually did that, like I did actually climb inside of him? So I used my hands in this paper, and I kind of did this with the string that I had put together. I still think it's beautiful, but I don't know if it fits for the project about long distance relationships. And then the these drafts, so I took that string again, and I decided that I wanted to show that entanglement that long distance relationships have. And I think this got a little bit closer than the last project that I did. So it shows kind of like that asphyxiation of something so beautiful and how it can sort of infest these things. And then the bags, I created a lot more of them. And then I started to hang them, and I realized that they looked kind of like they were dangling out of this window. And so I liked the pattern so much that I wanted to make a wallpaper out of them. And so I started to cut them out and make that happen. Next thing that I did was I did a performance piece that, because I couldn't find the right words and to talk about it in my research, the frustration that happens, this push and pull, the switching of energies that happen whenever your significant other is away from you. It's very much like a part of you is missing. Whenever you're trying to find yourself in a new place, you become very overwhelmed. For the performance piece, what I did was I recorded my partner's heartbeat. I used that as the rhythm in the background for the poem, and the poem that I wrote that I speak over top of it. And as the performance continues on, the vocals get louder and louder and more deliberate. I'm also wrapped up in like a lot of string. And so the idea is that I'm trying to escape from it while speaking these words, and the string keeps getting tighter and tighter and tighter. As I gradually get some of the string off, the idea is that that string then goes into the body that I've drawn out on the floor. And then we have more of the bags, so the wallpaper is getting finalized, and then it gets even more finalized, and that's actually the lyrics from the performance piece. So then we get to the final draft of this piece and this work all together. And so the first thing that the string that I was making wasn't really making sense, the knots that I was tying, and they said less of a metaphorical and more of a very physical material that embodies that connection and that fiber of being that's tangling and detangling. And so I learned how to spin thread using a drop spindle. The materials and the fibers that are in the thread itself, though, are the hair donated from both me and my partner, and it's spun together with red fiber in order to be final wallpaper design. It is a repeating pattern, and for the CAC show, I actually printed out 9-foot long strands that would go together in my specific area. There's currently 300 square feet of this wallpaper that was printed using an Epson printer by hand. So I printed 300 square feet of wallpaper by hand, and I ended up calling it FAM, She Explained, Wallpaper of 2019 to 2020. The reason it's called FAM is going back to the idea that this is made up of those bags that I was making and the extracts from people that I was gathering are in those bags. So the people in Cincinnati that I became friends with and I started to associate with eventually became my family, while I was still trying to maintain a relationship with my partner in Pittsburgh. Then the images that I decided were going to go on the walls, on top of the wallpaper, using glass frame, or not glass frames, but using frames with glass so that way you could see through the images at, in the border. The first one is called Shy of a Bundle, and they're lilies, and lilies are kind of like this sign of death, but they happen to be my favorite flower. And then the other image is called Somebody, Somebody. I was trying to work on a way to make it more vague, but that is actually my partner. Finally, so this is the final headset that I created. So the outside caps are actually made from dyed resin, and they have yellow roses in them and the red string that I was tying. The cord, the audio cord itself, is then the hair that I had spun with the red fiber. And it actually is a functional pair of headphones. I soldered the speakers into there. And what's cool about them, I think, is that if the audio cord gets damaged, it's replaceable. So there's an audio jack in the headphones themselves so that you can pull that out or plug it back in. And then, so I called that Fiber of Being, and then right next to that we had the Still Beating Chamber video performance that the headphones would plug into. I was really excited to see how people reacted whenever they learned that they had to put on these headphones. They had to adorn them in order to get to hear the performance itself. I was really, really excited to getting to see that happen, but unfortunately it didn't. And then that's my work. Thank you guys so much for tuning into this if you're watching. Also feel free to get in contact with me. I've included my email in case you have any further questions. Yeah, have a great one.